Luke chapter 2, verses 22 to 40. When the time of their purification, according to the law of Moses, had been completed, Joseph and Mary took Jesus to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be consecrated to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice in keeping with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon, who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Christ. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts. But the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required. Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." Child's father and mother marvelled at what was said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary, his mother, "This child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed, and a sword will pierce your own soul too." There was also a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Phanuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was very old. She had lived with her husband 7 years after her marriage, and then was a widow until she was 84. She never left the temple, worshipped night and day, fasting and praying. Coming up to them at that very moment, she gave thanks to God and spoke about the child to all who were looking forward to the redemption of Jerusalem. When Joseph and Mary had done everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee, to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong. He was filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was upon him. Have you, I wonder, ever read the story Horton Hatches the Egg, story by Dr. Seuss? Well, if you haven't, it's a story about an elephant called Horton and a bird called Maisie. So Maisie, the bird, is sitting on her egg in a tree, but she found the job boring. She said, "I'd take a holiday and fly off for a rest if I could find someone to sit on my nest." At just that moment, Horton the elephant walked by. Maisie asked Horton if he would sit on her egg while she took a little rest. Horton was not keen, but finally he agreed. Maisie promised she would not be gone long and flew off to Florida for a holiday. However, in Florida, Maisie had such a great time, she decided that she'd never go back to her nest. Back at the nest, days turned into weeks, and weeks turned into months. But Horton kept sitting there day after day. Winter came and icicles hung from Horton's trunk and his feet, but still he remained faithful to his promise to Maisie. "I'll stay on this egg and I won't let it freeze. I meant what I said, and I said what I meant. An elephant is faithful 100%. Well, there's a bit more to the story, which ends with Horton being rewarded for his patience and Maisie getting her comeuppance. But I guess you'll have to buy the book to find out exactly what happens. Horton kept his promise despite the hardship it caused him. It's an example that reminds us how important it is to keep our promises. "I meant what I said, and I said what I meant." It can be hard to keep promises, of course, but it's got to be at the heart of the Christian life. Let's mean what we say and say what we mean. There is, however, an even better example of promise keeping than Horton. It's found in the Bible reading we just had from Luke's Gospel. Now, there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel. The Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord Christ. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts. When the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required, Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." Well, God had promised Simeon that he wouldn't die until he'd seen the Messiah. We don't know how long Simeon had been waiting, but we do know that God kept his promise. God meant what he said, and he said what he meant. God was and God is 100% faithful. He keeps his promises to us, and there are very many of them in the Bible. One of my personal favourites is this from the book of Hebrews. God has said, "Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you." That's God's promise, which I testify to having found true. Never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. God sticks around. We can trust his promises. And if we can trust God's promises to us, should he also be able to trust our promises to him? Well, Peter, the apostle, friend of Jesus, in his letter to the early church, reminded believers there that God's promises are reliable. Peter said, "Do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promises, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance." So God is reliable. His promises are faithful, and he is patient, even if we don't always feel very patient ourselves. Well, likewise, in the Old Testament, God promised Abraham, Isaac and Jacob the land of Canaan. It was several hundred years, though, before Joshua led the people into that land, what we now think of as, what was it? The promised land, of course, the promised land. God waits for the right time, not always the time we want, but the time that's right. God's ancient promise of a saviour was fulfilled in the birth of Jesus. Mary's mother believed God's promises and was praised by the angel. "Blessed," said the angel, "blessed is she who has believed that the Lord will fulfil his promises to her." The American Baptist preacher Joseph Smith reminds us that we can all get distracted. Hopefully not so willfully distracted as Maisie the bird in Horton Hatches an Egg, but distracted nonetheless. "The shouts of today," Smith writes, "are so loud that I do not hear the echoes of yesterday, nor do I listen to faint whispers of tomorrow. All I really know is what is clamoring in my ear right here, right now. I forget what I've promised just because I'm trying to handle right now." And Smith quotes the American poet Robert Frost, who said in one of his well-known poems, "The woods are lovely, dark and deep, but I have miles to go before I sleep, and promises to keep, and promises to keep." The imperative, the insistence of the urgency of keeping promises. God had promised Simeon that he wouldn't die until he'd seen the Messiah. We don't know how long Simeon had been waiting, as I say, but we do know that God kept his promise. God meant what he said, and he said what he meant. God was and God is 100% faithful. So God sticks around. We can trust his promises. If we can trust God's promises to us, shouldn't he also be able to trust ours to him? Let's reflect on those thoughts and those verses and our promises to God and God's promises to us as I pray now. Let's pray. Lord God, thank you that in your faithfulness you promised to send a Saviour, and that Saviour came in person of your Son Jesus. Help us to rejoice in your reliability, your promise giving and your promise keeping. And help us in our turn to mean what we say and to say what we mean and to keep our promises to you and also to others. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Take care and God bless you.